So I would like first of all to thank the other co-author of this work, Professor Cornetti from Politecnico di Torino. Well, basically, different criteria in the framework of theory of critical distances have been proposed basically to overcome inelastic fracture mechanics drawbacks. Inelastic fracture mechanics drawbacks are related to the presence of notches, or basically if we wanted to describe the transition from long to small cracks, or if we want basically to catch the well-known size effects. And in the framework of TCD, we can distinguish between stress-based approaches, which of course are based on stress considerations, energy-based approaches, which are based on energy balance, and coupled approaches, which basically couple both stress and energy conditions. Finite fracture mechanics belong to this third category. And I would like just to give you the idea of finite fracture mechanics. So we have a notch, it can be basically a sharp notch, a blunt notch, a generic notch, I mean, and as you can see on the right, the criterion is described by two inequalities. The former is a stress condition, and the second one is the energy balance. Of course, thanks to Irwin's relationship, we are able to write the energy balance in terms of the stress factors and the material factor toughness. And for positive geometries, it means for monotonically decreasing stress field functions and for monotonically increasing stress intensity functions, the finite fracture mechanics criterion reverts to a system of two equations in two unknown. The first one is the failure stress, which is implicitly embedded in the stress field or in the stress intensity factor functions. And the second one is the critical crack advance. Note that differently from all the other criteria based on a critical distance, LC, the critical crack advance, of course, a fracture is supposed to propagate by finite crack advances, at least at the first step, LC becomes a structural parameter. So it's a function of the geometry and also of the material by means of LCH, which is the ratio square of K1C over sigma C, the well-known Irwin select. So these are the basis of finite fracture mechanics. And of course, just to give you an idea, it has some advantages. Of course, one of them is the physical soundness, because both stress and energy considerations are simultaneously fulfilled. And the other one is related to the fact that the crack advance is a structural parameter, so it's able to interact with the geometry under investigation. And for instance, if you look at this picture, you can see that's a three-point bending test on a plane specimen. And so for very small sizes, as it happens for some critical devices, you can see that if the crack advance is a material parameter, like for instance, the line method or quantized fracture mechanics, of course, basically predictions can go either to infinite or basically to zero. But thanks to the fact that LC is able to interact with geometry, finite fracture mechanics is able basically to provide a finite value. I'm not here the comparison with experimental data, but I can assure you that basically the matching is satisfactory. And now the goal of the study is to study the transition from short to long cracks, but not, I am going to speak about penny-shaped cracks. The name penny comes from the British coin, because one penny is 1 cent of a pound, at least from 1971, before it was even less. Anyway, this is why it's called the penny. And so this is the geometry that we have. So we have a crack having the shape of a disk with radius A, placing in an infinite, basically, solid body, loaded at infinite by uniaxial stress, as you can see. So A is the radius of the disk, R is the radial coordinate, and phi is the third coordinate, the azimuth one, but we are not going, basically, to implement symmetry. And so if we want to implement finite fracture mechanics criterion, so we have two conditions, a stress one and an energetic one, we need the stress field and the stress intensity factor function. So here we have the stress field, the longitudinal stress field, and of course we are able to derive the stress intensity factor function by means of its definition. And here, basically, I've decided also to report, this is the longitudinal section, and this is W is the longitudinal displacement. Now, having all these concepts in mind, we can implement the finite fracture mechanics criterion. So When we decided to study this geometry, we were not sure that Ewing's relationship was true or not, basically. So we decided, first of all, to evaluate the strain energy increments by means of the crack closure walk. So it's very classical. We obtain basically the expression on the right, and then we compared it by the solution achieved by means of Ewing's relationship, and they coincide basically. So it, we were not sure about this, but this was the result that we found. So in order to implement the energy balance in fiber fracture mechanics, we needed to compare basically the strain energy increment with basically the energy necessary, as you can see, to create the new annular fracture surface. Okay, because we have a penny shape, so of course we suppose to increase in this way by means of an annular surface. Now, so once the energy balance has been basically implemented, we can implement the estimation. So this is trivial. And so by equaling the right-hand side of these equations, we are able to get an implicit equation in the crack advance. So everything can be done in a semi-analytical way till this step. Of course, the implicit equation has to be solved by simple numerical schemes. And one the solution basically of this equation, so LC, is known. We can substitute into one of the previous equation to get the failure stress. And so this is finite fracture mechanics. We decided to implement other criteria, so classical basically linear elastic fracture mechanics, the one. The point stress method, where L basically becomes a material constant. And finally, we decide also to implement the cohesive crack model by assuming a Dugdale cohesive law. So you can see here the constitutive relationship. Of course, in that case, if we wanted to implement the cohesive crack model, we need the stress intensity factor related to a penny-shaped crack with annular surface subjected to a constant loading. And we need basically the displacement at the border of the loaded and loaded region. And then we have basically all the tools to implement the cohesive crack model. So we can get the size of the process zone by imposing that the stress field, the stress intensity factor at the fictitious crack tip is equal to zero. So of course, basically, we get that if we remove basically the loading, AP tends to zero, and if sigma infinite tends to the, if the applied loading tends to the tensile strength, basically AP tends to infinite. And finally, we can impose the crack growth condition. So the displacement at the real crack tip must be equal to the critical displacement, which can be expressed in terms of the fracture energy and basically the tensile strength. And we are able to get the failure stress and the process zone size at failure stress. So now let's look at the results. The first one is a comparison between, so we have the dimensionless failure stress as a function of the dimensionless crack basically depth. As you can see here, the inelastic fracture mechanics predictions of Floro predict basically reasonable predictions only for very large cracks. On the other hand, all the criteria based on a critical distance basically are able also to predict the transition from long to short cracks. And note that cohesive crack model predictions and finite fracture mechanics predictions are within 4%. On the other hand, those by the point method are basically more or less 16% lower. And I can comment also on the dependence of both AP and critical crack advance on the crack depth, but time is going to finish. So I want here just to compare the predictions related to Griffith crack, which is a center thickness crack, and the penny shaped crack. This is interesting because, as you can see, the knee point governing the transition from small cracks, which are basically stress governed, to large cracks, which are energy governed, moves from 1/π to π/4. And this is was an interesting result, according to us. And well, if you like this topic, we have also published recently a work on spherical cavities where penny shaped cracks represents basically an extreme situation. And I've finished. Basically, that's all for what concerns my presentation. Thanks for your attention.